11:10, so you've got about a minute to wiggle your way. There's no rush. We're just excited to have you guys here this morning. Good morning, good morning. Oh, that had a little spice, but I'd like a little more. Good morning. Yes, thank you guys so much for being here. Welcome to 1111. My name is Kagan Parker. I will be hosting us today as Tom is still out of town. We're missing our fearless leader, but we have a phenomenal guest speaker today, and she needs very little introduction, but Reverend Linda McDermott is here today to speak with us, and I'm very, very excited about what she has to say. And also, welcome to all of our online guests. We've actually got quite a few online humans. If you guys want to shout hey to them every once in a while, they're phenomenal, and we really enjoy having you guys there as well. I don't think there's any announcements, but it is October, and I hope you guys are doing something spooky. We love that. I think we'll go ahead and we'll get started with the welcome candle, and we'll get things off. We've got some wonderful music today, and we got lots of new faces, so we got to show out and show everybody how cool we are. Join me if you will. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, it doesn't matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Come, even if you have broken your vows 1,000 times, come yet again.
Thank you. Top of the morning to you, 1111 downtown. How's everybody doing? You gotta love this weather, right? Sweet. I'm gonna ask y'all to stand, and we're gonna sing a song out of the 1111 book hymnal. It's a classic from one of our great hymnists, Ben Harper. This is a super time to bring your offering to the table as well. Anytime during this song.
Okay, here we go. It goes like this.
It'll make you weak, mad, and mad. It'll make you mad and mad. It'll fill your heart and hands. I'll leave you with nothing at all. It's the eyes for the blind and the legs for the lame. It is love or hate and pride for shame. Sing with us. That's the power of the gospel. That's the power of the gospel. The gospel in every man. The gospel in the garden. And the gospel in the trees. The gospel that's inside of you. And the gospel inside of me. Good work, everybody. Would y'all just take a moment or several moments and offer one another a sign of peace? Just move on around the room. Thank you.
I love it. I love it. I really do. Good morning. Good morning again. It is so wonderful to see everyone so excited to see each other and to greet one another. The energy is just so beautiful today. Thank you guys for being here with all your smiles and your love. Can we get a big round of applause for Coffee? She's hiding in the back, but we appreciate you. It really does bring everybody a little more pep in the step. I have the pleasure of reading our reading for today. It comes from James 2, 14 through 19, and verse 26 as well, from the Message version. Dear friends, do you think you'll get anywhere in this if you learn all the right words but never do anything? Does merely talking about faith indicate that a person really has it? For instance, you come upon an old friend dressed in rags and half-starved and say, "Good morning, friend. Be clothed in Christ. Be filled with the Holy Spirit," and walk off without providing so much as a coat or a cup of soup. Where does that get you? Isn't it obvious that God talk without God acts is outrageous nonsense? I can already hear one of you agreeing, saying, "Sounds good. You take care of the faith department. I'll handle the works department." Not so fast. You can no more show me your works apart from your faith than I can show you my faith apart from my works. Faith and works, works and faith, they fit together, hand in glove. Do I hear you professing to believe in the one and only God, but then observe you complacently sitting back as if you've done something wonderful? That's just great. Demons do that. But what good does it do them? Use your heads. The very moment you separate body and spirit, you end up with a corpse. Separate faith and works, and you get the same thing, a corpse.
Whoa. I want y'all to sing with this. This is another 11-11 kind of standard. Goes like this. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart, open up all your eyes. We can all know everything without it's in every one of us, by and by. That was so good, we gotta do it again. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find It's in every one of us, by and by.
Well, good morning. This is our what we call Kairos time, and my chronometer here says it's 11:28. It's October the 9th, 11:28 a.m. That's Chronos time. That's how we mark time. But Kairos time is something a little different. Kairos time is a quality of time. And I brought a few family photos I want to show you. Margaret and I made a trip recently. So I have some vacation photos I want to show you. Because we marked some time, we captured some moments. And that's what you do with a photograph, you capture a moment, right? And so this picture right here is the Statue of Liberty with a sailboat in the background. And this picture right here is my lovely wife and our son. We were on a boat out in New York Harbor. This is our little scalawag 4-year-old grandson with his sand pile shovel sword tucked into his belt. He's got his eye patch on. You can't see that, but he has his pirate eye patch on. This is a little closer if you want to come up and look at these. This is Granny and Charlie with their eye patches on. These are all moments we wanted to capture. We wanted to capture these moments because we're going to remember those. And here's Granny reading to the little pirate, precious moment. And you can't see this one, but I want you to come up and look at this at the end. This is old Poppy saying, "Arr," like a good pirate should. We want to capture those moments. We want to remember those moments. They're very, very special moments. And that's what Kairos time is. It's a special moment. A moment we want to capture and remember. And so what about prayer? This is also our prayer time. And today, I don't know what to pray. Maybe you do, but I don't know what to pray. And so I'm going to fall back on Scripture. In Romans 8, the Apostle Paul says, even the Spirit helps us when we don't know how to pray. In other words, the Spirit will pray for us and through us. I don't know what your prayers are today, but this is a quality time, a time for us to capture the moment and be with God. Let us pray. Amen.
Thank you, George. I love it when you do Kairos, man. You can tell you've done this kind of thing before.
You ready for this one?
This song is crazy. Sun once went around the earth, according to the Holy Church, which helped to reassure people that they were the center of the universe. One day His Holiness the Pope met a man with the telescope. Said, Mr. Galilei, what does your spyglass say? And the scientist spoke. He said, it's really quite amazing. Entirely life-changing. So let me ask before I show you, do you really want to know? Do you really want to know? Am I read the Bible for direction? She said she was a child of heaven, and that the human race came from a higher place, from the angels descended. She wound up married in her cousin. He was a thinker of a husband. Lost in thought she'd find, see Charlie, what you writing? Darwin looked up and said, it's really quite amazing. It's entirely life-changing. Ask before I show you, do you really want to know? Do you really want to know?
Amazing. And it is so good to be back with you. I haven't been around here for some time. I'm Linda McDermott. I'm the other half of the McDermott pair. My other half is still in Michigan closing up a cabin, so he got all the hard work and I got to come home. We're also waiting on a new baby, the grandson, that's supposed to be here any second now. So if I get a text... But it's good to be with you. It really is. Before I start, today is probably closer to being a lesson than a sermon. So if we have time at the end, I want to give you a chance for a Q&A. We'll just talk. But before I do that, I want to ask you, do you really want to know? Because we're going to be talking about this. I hold in my hand a collection of writings that has changed the world, for good or bad. We can argue both, can't we? To an addict, this has provided them guidance and strength and courage and wisdom to be alive again. But it's also split families. We can't even meet together, some of us. or talk about anything. It has caused wars that include torture, death, destruction, and it has guided us to our higher angels. We need to talk about this. A lot of people have rejected it for all the wrong reasons, and I think it's time to take it back. It all comes down to one thing: interpretation. Interpretation. I was talking about this to Tom earlier in the week, and of course, if you know Tom, you know that he's going to go back and look up the etymology of a word, which is, amen, thank you. That was George. So it turns out that at its root, the same word for interpretation, the same root as intestines. I know. But if you think about it, it also has a notion of movement and maneuvering, so that to interpret in a raw and very real sense is to make your way carefully through the mixed master of language and contextual meetings. Jack, I told you I wasn't going to do this, but can you quick pull up the mixmaster? Never mind. Don't worry about it. We had a picture of a mixmaster. I told Jack I wasn't going to use it, but it's confusing. It's like this tangled up mess. And which way do you turn when we're trying to interpret, especially this Bible that is a collection of writings, poetry, hymns, the theologies of the prophets, stories, poems, from about a 2,000-year span that's been collected? How do you make sense of it? How do you make sense of it? Interpretation. Maneuvering through the confusion of nuance. I mean, did you know that the main reason we use so many emojis in our text messages is because we have to put nuance in there? I mean, if you have a text that says, let's get the one for the "Are you mad at me?" text. Nope. This is why, you know. Nope. Okay. Never mind. Take those down. There's a text. How many of you have had text messages and you don't know how to read them? You're like, are you mad? Are you being sarcastic? So if it has a kissy face on it, then you know maybe they're not mad. But if it has nothing, you don't really know how to take it, do you? But we use this. I've read this. Studies have been done. We need the emojis to help us imply the nuance of what we're trying to say. So a little context helps. Let me see this. Is there the one about the I'm good? Or I'm... Okay, I'll just tell you. So there's a slide, and a woman is at the airport, and she gets a text that says, "I'm here for you." She writes back, "Oh, thank you so much, because I have really been going through a hard time, and it just means so much to me that you would reach out like that." And the response is, "I'm your Uber driver." You need a little context, right? If she's sitting at home, maybe it was a supportive friend. But when you know she's at the airport, it makes a little difference. It's her Uber driver. So we have these messages, and interpretation becomes difficult for us. Let's see. Now we can do the Chinese lettering or with the bathroom. Let's try it. Oh, this is a literal translation. For restrooms, go back toward your behind. What happens when we translate things literally? It just doesn't match up word for word. So where's the one about the fall into the water? take care. Fall into the water carefully. Literally, that just doesn't convey what we meant it to. So even when people say, oh, I take the Bible literally, well, okay, which translation, which interpretation, who translated it from the Hebrew or the Aramaic into the Greek, into the Latin, into the, I mean, there are so many translations. We have to be careful. How do we do that? Go back into the Mixmaster illustration. So many translations, so many interpretations. Here's one. Looking at Paul's letters, look at the letter of Paul to the Galatians. It's a very early letter written before any of the Gospels were written, and he writes this in one translation. We are made righteous through faith in Christ. We are made righteous through faith in Christ. Now, a lot of Bibles interpret it that way, but as the King James has it, and 9 times out of 10, you're never going to hear me say this, but this time, I think the King James got it right. It says, we are made righteous through the faith of Christ. You see the difference? Having faith in Christ is an intellectual assent, versus having the faith of Christ means that we are followers of the ways of Jesus. Now, both of those can be correct. It's a hard translation to make. But you do have some choices, and people made those choices for you. 90% of them having faith in Christ. Just make an intellectual assent, and you're good. Nah, that's not it. But if we understand that Christians at that time were being referred to as the followers of the way, then it makes a lot of sense to interpret this as having the same kind of faith that Jesus had. That's how we're made righteous. A two-letter word, in, of, makes all the difference, doesn't it? Spanish explorers, I don't have a recent reference, I just remember this. I think they were in Central America. And they chopped off the hand of one of the tribal leaders because he would not confess faith in Christ. Say it. I have faith in Christ. Say it. He wouldn't say it. And they chopped off his hand. And he said, if this is the kind of God you have, I want nothing to do with it. Maybe he had the faith of Christ. Maybe he was kind and generous and compassionate, but he didn't say the right words. Part of our history. Interpretation matters. So, what to do? We're Methodists. We have a method. I love it. Some of you know this. If you've ever taken a class with me, you've heard me talk about the Wesleyan quadrilateral. A lot of you have taken classes with me. Now, are you willing to be honest? Are there people here who have not heard of the quadrilateral? Thank you. Thank you for admitting that. I think lifelong Methodists don't even know what it is. I think, personal opinion, the whole reason the Methodist Church has been messed up so much this last couple of years is partly because we don't understand the quadrilateral.
Or we forgot it.
Or we misinterpreted it. So I'm going to give you the Gil Farrell version. If you knew Gil Farrell, then you know where it's coming from. Okay. John Wesley, who began a movement within the Anglican Church, which became the Methodist Church, John Wesley had a method to help us with how we do theology. How we do theology, or how we understand God and our relationship to God, the quadrilateral is a methodology for theological reflection. It helps in our understanding and interpretation. It functions like a wheel. I'm going to go first. First, we're going to start with Scripture. Okay. Scripture. this book. It's been canonized. It's been reviewed. These are the books and the writings that have been chosen and said this is what's going to be the official version. Catholics have a little bit different. Of course, you know, the Jews have what we call the Old Testament. It's a little bit different, but for the most part, same Bible. Letters, stories, histories, words of the prophets, which I call the theologians of the Old Testament, wisdom literature. There's a lot in here. It's the source of understanding for Jews and Christians. It's where we begin our exploration, and it needs interpretation. So we start with scripture. Then we have the second one, which is tradition. Oh, yay, got it. What has the Christian community, the church, taught and practiced? We don't start a new religion with every generation. We don't start from scratch. We stand on some foundations. They have some cracks, but it's still a foundation, isn't it? We also bring in the traditions of our families, our culture, our society, traditions. Then we have reason. Zan Holmes, who was a pastor in Dallas, once said, you know, we're not inviting you to check your brains at the door. I love an old quote. I know I'm showing my age, but Archie Bunker once said, faith is what is believing what any dang fool knows isn't true. We need reason, don't we? Or we can be told a lot of stuff, and it's just, you just got to accept it on faith. I know it sounds stupid, but you just got to accept it on faith. Well, there is nothing in this collection that was written with the understanding of our universe, our solar system, nothing about electricity, medical research, mental illness, radiation. The list goes on and on about what they did not understand. I love the Galileo piece and the Peter Mayer song, Do You Really Want to Know? We know a lot of things, and somehow we got to mesh that in with our life of faith. And I think we're being told sometimes subtly that we got to choose one over the other, and we don't. It's called interpretation, scripture, tradition, reason. Even lately, I was in seminary 35 years ago, and there's a lot of new stuff out there. And you know why? Because of the Dead Sea Scrolls is a big one. Yeah, they were discovered before I was born, but they're just now really getting translated, interpreted, looked at, and made public. It took a long while for that to happen. So we're still learning, and it's changed some things that I thought about the Bible just by virtue of new information. We use our reasoning, and then all three of these were part of the Anglican tradition that John Wesley inherited, but this one is one he added, experience. John Wesley would talk about the experience of the Holy Spirit. I think we can adapt that as the Holy Spirit present in our lives at all times. There have been things that I read in Scripture, that I learned from a church, that I could make it reasonable. And then I met somebody, and it just didn't fit. And it changed my life. And that's happened more than once. My experience of being in this world, being in relationship to other people, being open and hearing other people, looking at another culture, has caused me to re-reflect on scripture, tradition, and reason. What you see here is a circle, because theology is not static. Our understanding of God is not static. It is done in community with an air of prayer and humility. We explore together. We are not here to finalize an answer or give you a workbook. We are here to do theology together so that we might be made better together. To love one another, to bring compassion into this world, to bring healing and wholeness into this world. Interpretation. So scripture, tradition, reason, and experience together form this circle. Never see it linear, because it's not. Now, I'll tell you the flip side that I've heard, and you're free to argue with me on this, okay? But I'm going to give you the Gil Farrell. He was one of my professors. Some people say scripture is primary. Gil Farrell said, if you do that, your circle is lumpy. Cha-chunk, cha-chunk, cha-chunk. They all must interact. Of course, scripture is sort of the boundary, maybe, of what we are applying this to. But all of these have to work together. All of these have to work together, informing each other. So, if we do theology as a community, and our aim is what we understand of God being compassionate, healing, good, then we must be willing to be open and discuss things with one another. And so, especially in this environment, you're not going to hear someone say, you can't say that, because you can. It's not doubt, it's curiosity. So, I don't know, what time is it? 5 till? Okay, we got 1 minute for Q&A. We'll take maybe two. What kind of questions or reflections, is this new to you? And if so, what does it feel like? Yeah, Dan.
Did we hear this in the pulpit?
I just did.
You just did. It's probably more appropriate for a lesson, and we need to teach it more. You're absolutely right. It used to be on our website. I don't believe it's there anymore, but it was on our website. This is how we do theology. Kagan in the back.
When you find your
A good example for me, and it's narrow, I understand that, but I'll try to give you an example of both. Scripture can be read to say that homosexuals are not to be included in the community of faith, okay? Tradition has taught that, right? Reason, I could make a reasonable case for that. I've heard people make a reasonable case, but my experience, and some of you know this story, I had a professor at UT that was teaching Bible, and I thought he was Jesus on earth, but I disagreed with everything he said. And then I saw him on the West Campus Mall sitting there in 1977 in front of God and everybody at the booth for the gays and lesbians, and I literally froze. And in my mind, I still see this. I kind of heard a voice that said, Jesus was here, that's where he'd be, and you are wrong. And I started over. Now, on the other hand, there have been experiences that might tell me that the world is bad, going to hell in a handbasket, and yet scripture informs me that there's a hope beyond that. So do you see, it can go both ways. Scripture has to be interpreted. It has to be interpreted. And I think one of the lenses we must use is love. If it's not loving.
How can I live in community with you if I disagree with you?
Oh, how can I live in community with you if I disagree with you? Who would like to answer that? And that's, you know, I think sometimes we can listen in a way that says, tell me how you believe, how you understand that, what informs that. Really listen to them and even affirm at times, okay, I can understand where you might feel that way. Would you be willing to hear a different perspective? Yeah. I have to love you. And loving means sometimes hearing things you really disagree with. That's a simplistic answer. That is a terribly tough thing to do. Because 9 times out of 10, they're not willing to give that in return. And that's where the catch is.
You know what's interesting? You say talking,
Well, there are so many of this is not people talking. I would change that word. So many, much of this is people not listening. There, everybody's doing so much talking, and we're not really listening. You know, if I want to talk about, what was it recently? Gun control. Okay, we can get into all kinds of arguments about this, but you know what? When children are getting shot in school, I can meet with the president of the NRA, and he's not going to tell me that he thought that was a good thing. Okay? So sometimes we just really have to listen. We probably can find some common ground. Okay. Band's ready to go, and you're ready to go to lunch, and as Tim used to say, so we can beat the Baptist to the white meat. So thank you for letting me be here today and engaging in this discussion. I hope you will go and read more about the Wesleyan Quadrilateral, and God bless you as you continue this journey with each other in conversation about who is God and how does God act in our own lives to change this world. Amen.
Thank you. dismissed. May the God of grace and love and compassion go with you, that you might see with your eyes the beauty of this world, the beauty in one another, and the hope that God always holds out before us. Blessings on each one of you. Amen.